Father, we just thank you so much.
Hello, precious partners and friends. This is Pastor Rich in the state of California. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be grateful, thankful, and thrilled in it. And remember, dearly beloved, you don't have a problem. All you need is faith in Almighty God. And when we use that phrase and we say that, that doesn't mean you're not going to go through sufferings. You're not going to have thorns in your flesh that you have to deal with. Matter of fact, I have some producers that believe in the supernatural. Had to go and do some prayer for me on my back. But I thank God that God is a wonderful miracle worker in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to talk to you for a few minutes, just signs of the time. I believe that we're living in end times. I believe we're living in the last of the last days. We're living in a constellation of time. I believe that God is on his way back. You can see the signs of the time. You can see biblical prophecy literally being fulfilled before us. You see it in Ezekiel talks about it. Daniel talks about that 70th week. And I want to let you know, even here in the state of California, this year was actually the hottest it's ever been in history. Something is happening in the weather department, not just in California, but all states and even around the nation. We see earthquakes. We see tornadoes. So much is going on, but the good news is the Lord warns us and he lets us know the things that's going to take place. Matter of fact, I want to go over to Matthew chapter 24 because the disciples were asking Jesus some very interesting questions. They wanted to know, when is the end time coming? When is the last days coming? So in Matthew chapter 24, verse number 3, and the word of the Lord reads, it says, and as he sat up on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came upon him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the signs of thy coming and of the end of the world? One thing that I love about the Lord Jesus Christ, when you ask him a question, he answers the question, and he goes right into dialogue and he begins to explain. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you. He said in the last days that there will be a lot of deception, anti-Christ spirit, men and women that would be anti-Bible, anti-man. He says, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, I am the anointed one, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. Listen to this. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. In other words, God says, listen, I don't want you to be discouraged. I don't want you to be disheartened. I want you to live every day like it's your last day. I want you to live to die. I want you to realize that you're just a pilgrim passing through. And then he goes on in verse number 7, for nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. And all these are the beginning of sorrow. Then he goes on in Mark. He says the same exact thing. Mark chapter 13, starting at verse number 3. And as he sat up on the Mount of Olives over against the temple, Peter, James, and John, Andrew asked him privately a question. In other words, he was always teaching his disciples. He was developing his disciples. He wanted his disciples to have 20/20 vision to know what was going to happen in the earth realm so nothing would catch them off guard. And then verse number 4, he says, tell us, when shall these things be and what shall be the signs when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus answered, listen to this, them saying, take heed lest any man deceive you, for many, remember he said that over in Matthew, he said, repeats it. He says, many shall come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and shall deceive many. And when you hear, listen to this, you'll hear of wars and rumors of wars. Don't be troubled. In other words, don't allow trouble to have dominion over you. For such things must needs be, but the end shall not yet be. For nation shall rise against nation, listen to this, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in diverse places, and there shall be famines and troubles there, and these are the beginning of sorrows. Now, I know some people believe that we're going through the great tribulation period now. I'm not from that school of thought. As we study the Word of God, and even when you deal with the pre-trib, post, mid, it's really a secondary issue, not something for us to fight over. I believe in the rapture of the church. I tell people all the time, when I'm gone, you can have you can have my security poodles, because I'm getting out of here. And I believe in the rapture. I believe that God's going to catch his church up before all judgment comes upon planet Earth. Let's also go over to Luke. Luke chapter 21, he says the same thing. And how many know when Jesus talks, you ought to listen? And when he says something one time, you really ought to pay attention. But he says it a couple of times, you better take heed. And so he goes on here and listen to what he says. I want to read a verse here, a very powerful verse, number 7. It says, and they ask him, saying, Master, but what? When shall these things be, and what sign, listen to this, will there be when these things shall come to pass? They're asking a question mark. And he said, take heed that you, listen, be not deceived, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, I am the Messiah. And remember, Satan is dangerous as a roaring lion. He's more dangerous as a wolf in sheep clothing, but he's the most dangerous as an angel of light. And dearly beloved, those that are listening from coast to coast and border to border, it's critical that you build a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and place your faith. Now, people get mad at me all the time. They say, well, man, you need to teach the people to put their faith in the government. Well, that's not what scripture teaches. That's not what any of my mentors taught me. They say, we love the government. We pray for the government. But we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? He will never fail you. He will never abandon you. And you know what I love about him? He means what he says and says what he means. And then he says, but when you shall hear of wars, and listen to this, be not terrified, for these things must come to pass. Let me skip down to verse number 26 for sake of time. And then he says, men's heart, this is very powerful stuff here, men's heart, failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Father, we thank you again for those that are listening on this telecast, those that are listening on YouTube, Instagram. We ask that you would bless all of the hearers, God, millions of people. Let us not just hear the word, but help us to obey the word in every area of our life. We realize biblical prophecy is being fulfilled right before us. Eschatology, end time events, is happening. And Father, we ask that you would wake up your church to realize that only what we do for Christ is going to last. Open up our ears today to hear and obey. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. There's several things that I want you to jot down that the Lord placed in my spirit to give to the people of God in regards to signs of the time. Number one, and these are not in chronological order, but you're going to hear a lot about globalization. You're going to hear a lot about one world government. Matter of fact, all the things that have happened, even during this pandemic and a crisis from coast to coast and border to border, I believe with all of my heart, all of my mind, all of my spirit, that this is a dress rehearsal of things that are going to take place. And I believe that men and women in the body of Christ, we better get back to the Word of God. We better get back to teaching the Word of God, because God wants us to know how to navigate even in these end times. But we can't navigate if we're not doing things God's way by walking by revelation of the Word of God. And then number two, one world government. Every time you travel now, everything's one world. You see this one world government, even the one world religion. Matter of fact, in Revelation chapter 13, I didn't read it today, but we taught on it some time back. Revelation chapter 13 talks about two beasts. It talks about a political beast, and it talks about a religious beast. In other words, this religious leader will work with this political leader to be able to implement the one world government. To be frank and honest with you, congressmen are scratching their head right now trying to solve problems that only God could really solve. But with this religious leader, let me say this, when he comes on the scene, and I do believe that the Antichrist is already here. I think people get in trouble when they start saying who the Antichrist is according to biblical prophecy. We don't know who the Antichrist is. It could be a man, it could be a woman, but I do believe that whoever it is already living. I think we should never speculate. We should never give our opinion because the stage is already being set. Everything for this one world government is already here. Matter of fact, as you travel certain places, money in some places are not good. You need some kind of credit card to be able to track your records and so forth. And so this religious leader has got to be popular. He's going to have to be liked and loved among all denominations, all reformations. He's going to have to be liked among the Muslims, the Baptists, Church of God in Christ, Apostolic, Buddha, and so forth, all of them, and the ones that I didn't mention. He's going to have to be accepted by all of these religious institutions to be able to work with this political leader. And of course, this political leader will again sign a non-aggressional pact with Israel. That's why we always have to have our eyes on the Middle East. Israel is the prophetic time clock for things that's going to transpire even in the not too distant future. Matter of fact, our former president, regardless of what your views may be of him, God used him to be able, out of all of the presidents of our history, to be able to recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. I said that to say this, that was part of biblical prophecy. I know Israel was recognized in 1948, but to be frank and honest with you, Israel was instituted back in the book of Genesis, the book of beginning, the book of creation. And so again, this political leader will work with this religious leader, and every group in society will accept this religious leader, because this religious leader will not have answers that are black and white. Their response will be many ways are to heaven, you know, the moon, and so forth and so on. And I don't want to get involved in all that. But this Antichrist, which will be a political leader, he will again sign that non-aggressional pact with Israel. He won't reveal who he is at first. He'll be very friendly. He'll be very loving, very kind, very smooth, likable. He won't reveal himself into the last 3.5 years of that great tribulation. Now, I hear Christians say, well, we're in the great tribulation, period. Not, no. Trust me. Yes, we do see some bad things happening, but thank God we still have some law-abiding citizens that believe in the Constitution of the United States and so forth. Can you imagine if we had nobody that believed in law and order? We would be in trouble. And so, number three, weather pattern is changing around the globe. We see that. I mean, I just heard over in the Louisiana area that they had another horrible situation that happened that took out so many people's homes, took out so many people's lives. And I mean, everywhere you seem to look, something is going on in the weather pattern. Matter of fact, even in our geographical location, it's like once you walk outside, you can sense something is in the air. I can't pinpoint it, but when you go back in the house, your filters are clean and so forth. You got that clean air. But once you walk outside, it's like something is just not right. And that's not just in our region. It's everywhere around the globe. And then number four, there's going to be economic financial crisis. Right now, I know real estate is very high in California and different places, but that can't continue to happen. There's going to be a time where there's going to be some major economic crisis that's going to happen, where people are not going to be able to handle that. Some people will not be able to survive that. And that's why we keep pushing the people, regardless of your nationality, regardless of your background or your political background, put your faith in the finished work of the cross. Put your faith in Jesus. Make sure Christ is the object of your faith, because if Christ is not the object of your faith, you're not going to be able to survive. You're not going to be able to stand the things that's happening even right now in the hour and time that we live in. And then number five, there's an antichrist spirit. It seemed like there's an antichrist spirit everywhere you go. I mean, people are anti-Bible, anti-church, anti-man, and hardly anybody in the body of Christ is saying anything about it or preparing the troops, equipping them, empowering them to know how to navigate in this hostile environment when it comes to Christians. I mean, Christians are literally being persecuted right now on some jobs when people find out that you are a Bible thumper and you believe the Word of God. I mean, some of the demonic and satanic things that are happening literally blows my mind, especially when we live in a country. The United States is the greatest country of all, and our country was built upon biblical foundational truths that are laid in the Word of God. And I know we've got far away from that, but you can see the verbiage, you can see scriptures and writings, even U.S. Capitol, and even in some of those founders that God graced even in our country. And then number six, diseases that would have medical experts confused. There's so many new diseases. We're letting people come into our country. And don't get me wrong, I mean, all of us are some kind of immigrant. We came in the right way. But I believe you have to vet people. You can't just let career criminals come in here without checking their backgrounds, without checking anything on them. I think that's a dangerous situation. And matter of fact, I go on record to say this. I believe that we have terrorists already in all 50 states. And they're actually watching, and they're paying attention of all the things that's going. The sad thing about it, those terrorists hate Israel, they hate Christians, and they hate the United States of America. And I don't comprehend. That's certainly, I'm not an expert, but I am filled with the Holy Ghost. I can't understand how we would let somebody come into a country without checking things out. I mean, you know, especially when we're pushing certain laws and certain things upon American United States citizens, but we're not even pushing that up on other people. And so that's something that we really got to be praying about and paying attention to. And then seven, earthquakes. Earthquakes. There was an earthquake that I felt even in my house, and I turned the news on about 10 minutes, and you know, it took about 15 minutes before they had recognized it. And I mean, it was like you could feel that shaking. I believe that we're going to see more of that. I remember when my grandparents were alive, and they said there was a prophecy of an earthquake that was coming to San Francisco and even up north. And some of those prophecies came to pass, but I believe God is not finished in that area. We know God doesn't do bad things. The reason why we see these bad things is because of the first Adam, because we're in a fallen state and we're hostile toward God. Thank God for the second Adam, which is represents Jesus Christ, where he comes to bring peace and love and so forth. And then number eight, lawlessness. I mean, lawlessness is everywhere. I was in the Bay Area, and I can't comprehend. I mean, we have 58 counties in California, and there were so much shootings going on by youngsters, and they got the toughest gun laws around, and I just couldn't comprehend just the black on black killing. And and I don't hear anybody from any of these groups discussing the black on black killing, and I don't hear any of the politicians saying anything. I think really we need to take the National Guards in there and clean these areas up. If you want to be a thug, you want to be a hoodlum, there's going to be consequences to that. I believe in respect and law and order. You know, everybody's not bad. Of course, there's bad in everything, but you know, we have to have law and order, and we can't be afraid to walk the streets of America and be afraid. Matter of fact, in one of the counties, they were talking about pain. Listen to this. This was, I thought I was hearing things. I thought maybe I was, you know, paying career criminals to give up their guns. $400 a month, which a criminal will take that. That won't stop murder in his heart. There's other ways you can murder a person. They'll take that check, and they, and that county can afford to pay for that to stop an individual. And I do believe in prison reform. I'm not going to knock that, but I believe when you got hoodlums that will tell you straight up, if you let me out, I will kill again. That, why would we let someone out that's telling you, I don't want to change, I'm not going to change, if you let me out, I'm going to do the same thing. Now that's a problem right there. And we've been having tragedies because we let folks out that's telling you, they're prophesying, this is exactly what I'm going to do, and they do it. And so we got to really pray in regards to that for our law enforcement. And we have to pray for Homeland Security and pray that God would send godly men and women into our judicial system that will look through the lens of God, that will have mercy and compassion. But at the same time, if you don't want to change, not going to tolerate no foolishness in the name of Jesus. And then again, number nine, one religion denying the deity of Christ. You know, and let me say something. Everybody believes in Jesus. Everybody believes in Jesus. The problem is, which Jesus are we talking about? Are we talking about the historical Jesus of the Bible? Most people say, oh yeah, I believe in Jesus. He was a good man. He was a good prophet. He was a great teacher. But when we talk about deity, we're talking about Jesus being God incarnated in the flesh to go to Calvary to pay our sin debt in the name of the Lord. We don't believe in reincarnation. We believe in incarnation. Reincarnation, people believe, well, I'm coming back as a pig, coming back as a dog. No, we believe in incarnation, which God came. He was already unformed, unmade. Jesus, from the beginning, he was impregnated into Mary, a virgin, not to be a baby, but again, to grow up, to go to a cross to pay our sin debt on Calvary. But again, we're going to have a lot of people that deny the deity of Christ, meaning Jesus is not just the Son of God. Jesus is God. Oh, yes. And we don't believe in three God. We don't believe in tritheism. We believe in one God revealed in three persons, co-equally and co-eternally, but distinct one from another. Boy, that'll mess you up in the finite mind. You got to have faith. You may not comprehend it, but you can certainly apprehend it through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And remember, the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is, listen to this, glory to God, our heavenly intercessor. But the Holy Ghost, and you hear me talk a lot about the Holy Ghost, because in these end times, you're going to need to be in partnership with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is our earthly intercessor. And so God wants us to have access to our earthly intercessor as well as our heavenly intercessor. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for those that are viewing our telecast today. Father, we ask that you would just bring miracles and healing and deliverance in every area of our life. And Father, we thank you for waking us up. We're sons and daughters of Issachar. We can see the signs of the time, and we will know how to navigate even in the hour and time that we live in. The Bible is more up to date than ABC, NBC, CBS. The Bible's more up to date than CNN or Fox Network, but we have to read it. We have to ask the Holy Spirit to help us to comprehend so we know the seasons and time. In Jesus' name, amen. Now listen, you may be listening and you have never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. I'm not asking you to join a church. I'm asking you to be part of the global family. There's millions of Christians, even during this end time, that has not bowed. Hallelujah. That believe in the Word of God, that believe in the Constitution. And we thank God we have leaders that's still around that believe. We do have a remnant. But the Bible says in Romans 3, in verse number 10, it says, there's none righteous, no, not one. Even on your best day, sir, respectfully, ma'am, the Bible says that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But Jesus did utter and say this. He says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I want you to pray this prayer with me in the name of Jesus. Just close your eyes, and if you're in a safe place, and pray this in sincerity and truth, and say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of all of my sins. I believe that you died for my sins, and that on the third day, God the Father raised you from the dead. And right now, Lord Jesus, I invite you into my heart as Lord and Savior. Dearly beloved, if you prayed that prayer in sincerity and in truth, of course, people get mad when we pray the prayer because they say, oh, there's more to the prayer. We know that. But you start by receiving Christ as Lord and Savior. But then you mentorship. Discipleship is very important. Your discipleship is going to determine if you win or lose. Your discipleship is going to determine if you swim or sink. And so you need to be a part of a Bible teaching, Bible believing church, even if it's through social media, Zoom, YouTube, wherever you're comfortable at. Find you a place that's going to teach the truth of the gospel, because God's word is true and every man's a liar. God bless you. This is Brother Schumacher. We're praying for you, and your best is ahead. Have a glorious day.